It took me 10 years to get into medical school, and the first 4 out of the 5 questions that I was asked were the exact ones which my friends who got in 2 years before me were asked. So there's a very big chance that if you watch this video till the end, that some of the questions are going to be the same ones you will experience in your own MBChB interview. I must say that the 4th one is the most important one regarding finances. A university is a business at the end of the day, and their interest is big on paying the bills and the running costs of the university. You do not want to fumble when you give an answer to that one. So stay tuned. Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Dawn. On this channel, we call each other mighty conquerors because there is nothing we cannot do through Christ Jesus who is our strength. If this is your first time tuning in, a very special and a warm welcome to you, to my returning viewers and new subscribers. Thank you so much for tuning in once again. I truly appreciate your support, and I pray that on this channel you will find peace, encouragement, and strength in your journey with Christ together with me. So today's video is about me answering the 5 questions that I was asked in my MBChB interview back in 2021. I am currently in my 3rd year this year by the grace of God, and one thing I can assure you is that they do repeat some of the questions. 2 years before me, I had 2 friends who are in their 5th year now who I sat down with and asked them the questions that they were asked in their own interview, and 4 of those questions were the ones I was asked. The last one is the one that I least expected, so it was really helpful for me to take the time I needed to answer, to think about the question and what I wanted to say before actually giving my answer. The interview itself was about 20 minutes long, which means that you have about 3 to 4 minutes to answer each question. That gives you enough time to answer. You don't need to rush through the interview. I promise you that in my interview, there was probably like dead silence for like the first 10 seconds of each question before I answered. I made sure that I gather my thoughts, I keep my peace, and I think about what I needed to say. This was honestly the only opportunity I had to get into medical school after 10 years of not getting accepted. It was literally the first invitation I received in those 10 years. I strongly recommend that in addition to watching this video, that you go to TikTok, Instagram, and even LinkedIn and look for students who are currently in their own first year right now and ask them which questions were they asked during their MBChB interview, because the chances are they are going to be repeated. So I hope that this video will be really helpful to you and that it will really, really, really help you win and be successful in your own interview. So the first question I was asked is, what makes people sick and why did I decide to study medicine? So what I believe makes people sick is any kind of emotional and spiritual unwellness or imbalance, in addition to biological factors like toxins in the environment and genetic factors that can result in inherited diseases. In terms of emotional and spiritual unwellness, something like a traumatic event that happens to someone, maybe the death of a loved one, or witnessing or being part of a motor vehicle accident. The post-traumatic stress from that, you know, can cause someone to have depression, anxiety, and as a result of that emotional instability, they can have physical symptoms that manifest as a result. Okay, so for me, honestly, medicine, besides the fact that it's a calling, it's a pleasure for me to feel another person's pain and to be able to do something about it. I've always been someone who had compassion, and it really aligns with my personality, because when I think back to my primary schooling in grade 7, I had an opportunity to go and volunteer at a soup kitchen, and I really, really felt like I wish I could do more for the people that I was helping at that tender age of 13 years old. So that's the reason why I decided that I want to go into a field where I can offer a personal service to the next person, be able to be a shoulder for them to cry on, and be able to do something about it too. You know, as much as we have the allied health professions and other social degrees like social work, nursing, which also offer this personal service, but I feel like with medicine, the difference is that it's not just the medical intervention that I'm able to help the person with, but we are also trained in medical school to deliver counseling to the person psychologically, to also offer advice that relates to their lifestyle, their social environment, and their family life. I also mentioned that I felt that when I was in research, as someone who has a master's in medical physiology, I really struggled to get a clinical picture of what I was researching about. So that's why I felt like I'm not really satisfied in this field. The second question they asked me, what is my experience of healthcare, for example? My experience of healthcare is in the capacity of a patient, right? I was once admitted into hospital because I was having heart palpitations and fainting and getting these weird, you know, cardiovascular or heart-related symptoms. And clinically, I was treated very well. I got all the treatment that I needed, but on a personal level, the interaction with the doctors and the nurses, you know, was a little bit cold, you know, like there was a lack of empathy. So if there's one thing I could change regarding the experience that I had in healthcare, is for doctors and nurses to have a program maybe once or twice a year where they are able to go and learn how to be empathetic, you know, learn some social skills, you know, because it's clear that after a long time of being in this profession, you kind of do become desensitized to, you know, people or the patients because of all the trauma that you see. So you do burn out, you know, in this profession emotionally. So something that can be like a workshop or a seminar that the department can do for healthcare workers would really make the healthcare experience better for a patient. The third question was, how have I emotionally prepared for this degree? Again, I used personal experience. So I said that as a child of God, I go to church, I'm a servant in the house of the Lord, I'm a born-again Christian. I believe that having a spiritual place that feeds into my own health emotionally, like a church, really helps one to avoid getting burnout, to also have a safe space where they can run to when they are overwhelmed emotionally. So for me, church is that place. You know, there are people in church who over the years I have cried out and confided in when the going went tough, especially during the time when I lost my mom, when I was still in my third year of my BSc degree back in 2015, you know. So that was really helpful because her passing came during final exams around October, November of my final year. So if it was not for the church, you know, emotionally, I was not going to finish that degree in record time because I was not going to have the emotional strength, you know, to sit down for the rest of my examinations, you know. So I've also found that exercise, you know, has helped me to avoid burnout, you know, especially now as someone who is working and having a hobby. You know, I'm a YouTuber, I use that as an outlet, and it really helps me emotionally to rest, if I can put it in that way. So for the fourth question, I was asked, how was I prepared financially for this degree? And this is a really important question, because the university is a business, guys. You know, they have running costs, they have staff members to pay. The last thing that they want is to accept a student into any program that won't be able to pay and become a financial burden on them. So in as much as I didn't have a solid financial plan, I was very, very strategic in how I answered this question. I did not lie. You know, I mean, you can't fool the interviewers. These people have years and years of experience interviewing thousands and thousands of students. So they will know when you are lying. They will know when you are making answers up, you know. Hence why I always made sure that I draw from my own personal experiences to support my answers, to avoid making things up. You know, that's one thing you don't want to do. Lying is not the solution. Be honest, be true to yourself. Okay, so for me, obviously, my dad doesn't work, you know, and thankfully at the time of this interview I was working, but I had just started like 6 months ago, so it was not long enough for me to say, okay, I have this big savings account that can finance the whole 6 years of my studies during this degree. So I did manage to save enough to pay for my own registration and the first half of the year of my first year. For the second half of the year and the rest of my degree, I will apply for bursaries, and I have applied for some already, and I'm trusting God that He will make a way. And also, I do have one family member who has availed themselves and is willing to be collateral, you know, for a loan should it come to a point where I need to take a student loan, because I do realize that it's going to be a challenge to get financial funding or a bursary as a postgraduate student who already has a qualification. The fifth and final question that I was asked was the one that I least expected. It was not a question that they had asked my two friends in the 2 years before my own interview. So it's one of those that I had to answer on the spot, right? And this is the question where I literally took a breather for like 30 seconds, if not a whole minute. There was complete silence in that interview, because I told myself that I'm not gonna miss this one opportunity I have. You know, these people have experience in interviewing students, so they won't mind if I'm just dead silent and thinking about my answer. And I actually like told them that, okay, can you just give me a few seconds to think about my answer? And they didn't mind. So do take control of the interview. It's your interview, you know. Take ownership of it. Own it, you know. Own that interview. Make it favorable for you. Yeah, so the question was, since I am significantly older than the students I will be in class with, how will I deal with the age gap? So again, I use personal experience to answer this question. So as somebody who is currently working, you know, I have colleagues, you know, some who are older than me in terms of age, but are younger than me in terms of work experience, and others who are younger than me in terms of age, but are older than me in terms of work experience. But the way things are in the workplace for me is that we do not discriminate or judge each other or look down upon each other's opinions and contributions to our work, because at the end of the day, we all have the same goal, which is to maintain the success of the company and to keep it growing. So as colleagues, we overlook, you know, the qualifications that we have and our age groups. You know, we are one, we are the same, because we all have the same goal, you know. So going into this degree, I will treat my fellow classmates as my colleagues, because that's what they will be to me one day when we all finish this degree at the end of the day. And if you want to know how I actually finally got the opportunity to sit down for this interview after 10 years of applying into medical school, do watch the video where I take you through my journey into medical school. There are a lot of important things that universities don't tell you that I mentioned in that video, and maybe one of those things will be an eye-opener for you too, and hopefully help you also break through into this program. Let me know in the comments if you are sitting down for your interview this year or anytime soon, so that I can pray with you. And I wish you all the best with your interview. You will win, you will succeed, and I'll see you in my next video. Hey mighty conquerors, have you given your life to Christ yet? He said, in this world ye shall have many troubles, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. So why don't you give your life to Christ today to taste and see that the Lord is good? His promises are yes and amen. So I invite you at this very moment to take this short prayer of salvation with me and accept the Lord Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of your life. Heavenly Father, I come to you in prayer, asking for the forgiveness of my sins. I confess with my mouth and with my heart I believe that Jesus Christ is your Son, and that he died on the cross of Calvary, that I too may be forgiven and have eternal life. I believe that Jesus rose from the dead, and I ask you right now to come into my life and to be my personal Lord and Savior. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Welcome to the kingdom of God. May God bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May he lift up his countenance upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. God bless you and shalom.